Hello, everyone, and welcome to today's session. The session has started, and you're invited to add in the chat box where you're from and anything else that you'd like to add. My name is Nellie Deutsch, and I'm going to be moderating the session for our presenter. And our presenter is right here with a star. So a little bit about Jen. Let me just open that up. And just a second. Okay. Just feel free to add to the chat as we go. Okay, Janvier or Jen is a lecturer and researcher in the United Kingdom in Glasgow, at Glasgow College. He's a lifelong learner, and I can attest to that. He's quite busy now with his work as an instructor, but he is very keen on learning as much as he can about blended technologies and teaching, whether through computer-assisted learning and mobile. And his idea is to share what he knows. He believes that through education, that the daughter of a peasant can become a doctor, that the son of a mine worker can become the head of the mine, and that the child of farm workers can become the president of a great nation. This is a quote by Nelson Mandela that Janvier follows. So it gives me great pleasure to pass on the mic to Janvier. There's your PowerPoint presentation. And we'll get started. People will be coming in as we go. Remember, this is being recorded, so you're able to get the recordings later on and listen over and over again. In addition, you can copy the chat. Really exciting. It allows you to get the links and everything so that you can continue. And I see that, Jen, you're not in as co-presenter, which means that I will pass on the mic to you, which is fine. Let me just find you. Good thing we don't have over 1,000 attendees, or I would not be able to do this. Okay, and I still can't do it. I can't seem to find our presenter, even though I did see him a few seconds ago. Okay, here we go. All right. So technology, there we go. I will probably hear you, but the webcam is not available yet. But that's okay. We don't really need a webcam. If you find that my webcam or anybody's webcam, there we go. We only see the top of your head. There we are. Now we see the rest. Okay, so good morning, good afternoon, everyone. And good evening, whatever it happens to be. Our speaker is ready to go, and I'm going to stay in the background. So thank you. Thank you, everyone, for joining, and thank you, Janvier, for coming.
Morning or afternoon, everyone. Can you hear me okay? Hello, can you hear me okay? Thank you, Nelly. Thank you, Yara. Thank you, hello. Thank you, everyone. Good morning, if you are in the morning where you are, and good afternoon. We are in Glasgow in the UK, about 5 past 5. So I don't know where you are. Maybe you can tell me in the chat where you are, and also if you can't hear me, tell me if I can maybe raise my voice. So where are you from? What time is it? Where you are? Thank you. Thank you very much. Fabian. I can see that. Poland, yes. Anna. Thank you, Anna. And yes, I can also see the time. Tom, thank you very much. Thank you. Now, let's get started. Please, if you can't hear me, raise your hand or tell me so I can shout or raise my voice, okay? First of all, thank you for coming. As you can see on the primer on the first slide. I've been talking about Moodle in Africa, and my question is, can Moodle be used to educate the masses in Africa? That's a question I will try and answer as much as possible with you. The plan is first to introduce myself and give you some background information for ICT in Africa, and also a training project I was involved in, a Moodle training project. I will talk about the research study in details and the user experiences, and I will show you how I have collected data, and I will analyze the experiences and also the user comments, what they have said after the training. And I will make recommendations to policymakers. Of course, these may be policymakers in Africa, but also from my personal experience here in the UK, some of the recommendations may also be applicable to different projects. I make conclusion and references. Okay, can you go on, okay? So can I ask quickly how I can move on? Nelly, can you please make sure I have the control so I don't have to keep asking? Yes, I know. I think I know where I'm at. I know I can't see about it. Okay, now, biography, by myself. I'm John Vian Goronziza. I can see the name, also the picture. You can see the video. I'm a lecturer. I teach languages. I teach ISO as a second language at the University of Glasgow College. I also teach French in the
Good morning, good afternoon, everyone. Can you hear me okay? Hello, can you hear me okay? Thank you, Neri. Thank you, Yarek. Thank you, hello. Thank you, everyone. Good morning, if you are in the morning where you are, and good afternoon. So here in Glasgow in the UK, it's about 5:05. So I don't know where you are. Maybe you can tell me in the chat where you are, and also if you can't hear me, tell me so I can maybe raise my voice. So where are you from? What time is it where you are? Thank you, Remo. Serbia. I can see that. Poland, yes. Anna. Thank you, Anna. And yes, I can also see the time. Tom, thank you very much. Thank you. So now, let's get started. Please, if you can't hear me, raise your hand or tell me so I can shout or raise my voice. Okay. First of all, thank you for coming. As you can see on the planner on the first slide. I've been talking about Moodle in Africa, and my question is, can Moodle be used to educate the masses in Africa? That's a question I will try and answer as much as possible with you. Now, the plan is first to introduce myself and give you some background information for ICT in Africa, and also a training project I was involved in, a Moodle training project. We talk about the research study in details and the user's experiences, and I show you how I have collected data, and I will analyze the experiences and also the user's comments, what they have said after the training, and I will make recommendations to policy makers. Of course, these may be policy makers in Africa, but also from my personal experience here in the UK, some of the recommendations may also be applicable to different contexts. Depends. I make conclusion and references. Okay, can you go on? Okay. So can I ask quickly how I can move on? Nelly, can you please make sure I have the controls so I don't have to keep asking. Yes, I know. I think I know where I am now. I know I can't see the button. Yes. Okay. Now, biography by myself. I'm Jean-Vien Gorunziza, I can see the name, also the picture, if you can see the video, top right corner. I am a lecturer. I teach languages. I teach ESO as a second language at the City of Glasgow College. I also teach French in secondary school, and I have been training African colleagues face-to-face in Africa for about 3 years now. I will give you more details later. Now, where I come from, it's central of Africa, as you can see, if you follow the blue arrow, so the blue line there, should be an arrow, but it's not showing, okay. So Burundi. Burundi is one of the poorest countries in the world. It's in the center of Africa, next to Congo, Democratic Republic, or Rwanda, or Uganda. Does anyone know where on earth Burundi is, or has anyone been there or heard any stories about Burundi or the region at all? No? Okay. Okay, then, now we need to give you more information then. Now, this country is where I come from, and it's been through many decades of war, and hundreds and hundreds of people have died, and others have fled the country. Infrastructure has been destroyed. Oh, I can see somebody who's from Andrea. Oh, yeah, good. Oh, good. It's good to know. Where are you, Andrea, from? Where are you based just now? Oh, have 10 students from Burundi. Good, goodness, well done, that's good. The world is short, yes. Now, anyway, so the infrastructure has been destroyed, and so people had to flee the country, and there was a drain, and I'm one of the product of brain drain myself, because I'm based in the UK. Yeah, so, next, I give you, more information. I'm sorry, I'm going to give you a lot of background information here, just in case people don't know much about where I come from or any of those background information or piece of information. Now, I have been able to go to Africa to train my colleagues through Migration for Development in Africa, and they provide the funding, and they are based in Belgium, and there's a project called Migration for Development in Africa, MIDA, as you can see there. And I was there working with colleagues at universities, the University of Burundi, where I graduated, and I was a lecturer a few years ago, maybe a decade ago. And also at the University of National University of Rwanda, next door neighbor, and also at Kigali Institute of Education in the capital city of Rwanda. And also I went to Congo Democratic Republic, where I trained lecturers of Bukavu Catholic University on how to use Moodle, so through or thanks to the funding. And as you can see, these are the universities where I was involved as a trainer. So the top one there, University of Burundi, I went there in 2010 and 2012, and I spent a few weeks there training lecturers. And at University of Burundi, as you will see later, the university was the main organizer, and about five universities had to come together. They worked in partnership, and they were there and they were training them. And I give you details about the project as we go along. So also, as I said, National University of Rwanda, I was there a few times training university lecturers, assistant lecturers, librarians, and also at Kigali Institute of Education. Next, I need to give you some more information about ICT challenges in Africa. Some of you might know, those who have worked there or who live there. Now, there are so many ICT challenges. There's low computer ownership and slow internet connectivity in some places, or in most places. And electricity is very unreliable. When I was training there, and particularly in Congo, in Burundi, it was much electricity power cut, and they had to use alternative means so that we can keep training. So there's a low internet usage, as can you see one of the bottom points there, low internet usage, 18% population. This is according to US Census or Bureau 2010. If you want to follow through this, you can click on the link there, World Bank report, and pay and have more information. There's little training, staff training, as Masanja said, in 2010. More background information on this slide here. Challenges, so many challenges, as you can see. In Burundi particularly, the high level or the high level of poverty, less than a dollar a day, and most of the population they live in the rural areas, and there's very low internet access, and the cost of internet are high. And as I said to you, because of war, the infrastructure was destroyed, like telephone lines, so there's a lack or sufficient infrastructure there. More information, should you need to know, is that challenges in Burundi again, in terms of resources, skills shortage, is a shortage of skills in ICT and in the teaching staff training. It also depends on foreign expertise, which is why actually I have been called upon to go and lend hand in this area of Moodle or e-learning, because not many people had the experience. I should also say that the funding I was talking about on one of the previous pages on the slides, it was about trying to encourage people who are based in Europe, who have good skills and want to go in Africa and help with training, help with the education and development, project development, and things like that. Now the problem, as I said, the urging teaching and academic staff. One organization I got some information from called OAG, Observatoire de l'Action Gouvernementale, 2010. 70% of the University of Burundi teaching staff are more than 50 years old. This might also be a case in some other places you know. Maybe you can tell me later where you're based. More challenges face the country through implementation of ICT. Of course, there's a strategy, there's ICT strategy and policy, but very poorly implemented. Large classes, as you can see, between 200 and 300 students in the science lab. When I was a teacher there myself, I had about 250 students in my class, and I was a language teacher. You can imagine how hard things can become to get people to communicate or to interact with you or interact with each other. So, very big challenges. Next, opportunities though, get bogged down. It's not only challenges, there are opportunities. As I said, there's a strategy, ICT strategy and policy in place. And they have a vision of 2025 where they want everyone to have universal access to ICT, and they want Burundi to be a center for excellence and health. This is not just the case for Burundi, by the way. The same policy or vision applies to Rwanda, where I have been training also. They have this vision of being an excellence and hub for ICT and getting people to access ICT as much as possible. This in terms of strategy goals, practice is something. Again, in Burundi, there's what they call BBS, Burundi Backbone System. With this system, it is expected that prices will drop. And it's going to be a faster internet connection and greater awareness of ICT importance in terms of economy impact and education. So if, for instance, people are using to are starting to use ICT, you know, expect that it's going to create a lot of employment and jobs, and also in education in terms of research and online learning. So higher mobile cellular subscription, this is a good strategy, a good opportunity for people in Burundi, also in some parts of Africa, where there's high and there's very high penetration of mobile learning, mobile phones. The World Bank says that in Burundi, 25.6% of the population have got, out of 100 people have got mobile phones, which is good news. Now, universities, that was just in general, the few government we've just had a look at before. Now, at university, what is it like? Particularly at the University of Burundi, where I had to train about 40 teachers. There's much use of ICT at the University of Burundi, but still insufficient. It's connected to, ICT and computers are connected to 6 sites and they are interconnected. 500 computers, and students also have access to computers. And there's e-library development at the university, where they want to share materials, library materials in the whole region, not just at the university level or the country level, but also in Congo and Rwanda. However, there's poor research in general, and this is from ARE 2007 and Observatoire Research. Yes, 500 computers. Yeah, and I know it's very significant. Now, other universities, not just Burundi, University of Burundi, as I said, but also Université Lumière, which is a private university, and École Nationale Supérieure, ENS, which is a public university, and Université du Lac Tanganyika, also another university I was training. Teachers for now. Once again, in all those, there's minimal infrastructure and yes, Mrs. Mala, you can relate to that. So University of Lumière, they said, and so basically 4 or 5 university were staff were there for looking for training, so they develop more knowledge and skills. Now, once again, more information there, as you can see on the picture there, there's marked but insufficient university, as I said before. I think this is what the slide, I think I should move to next one. Yes. So now, the training project, as I said, I was involved in training university lecturers, librarians, and the ICT staff also in the design and the development and implementation of Moodle. Now, this project was about building the capacity of staff. So the point was to get them to learn the skills, develop them, implement courses, create courses, and then by the end of maybe a 2 or 3 year period, they will be able to train others. That was the aim and the hope for the project. Now we see whether this has been achieved or not later. They had to design material, teaching material also, as well as me. I was also asked to design teacher training materials, so they can use material for themselves, for learning, for practice, and also for others. Now, as I said earlier, the beneficiaries, as you can see, academic staff, Center for Research and Retraining, PEACE, this one picture you see here, and they got the funding, and they had to work in partnership with other uni departments and other universities to make things happen. So I also had to teach university researchers, as this is a center for research, and librarian and support staff, and in ICT and other people. Now, this is the title of the trailer of the project, if you like. It was called Introduction and Use of Moodle in Burundi. Now, once again, I'm kind of you know, repeating myself here, five universities, local and regional, and one of them was from Congo. As you see, the bottom one hand, bottom point here, University Catholic de Bukavu, and others were from Burundi. So basically five universities there. Now, partnership working, as I said, I had 40 participants, 40 lecturers, and 40 assistant lecturers. So altogether 40 people. The age ranged from 20 to 60, and had 13 women and 27 men. So the language of instruction you would imagine in French. I should have said earlier that Burundi, in Burundi, the language of communication and administration is French. Like in some other countries, like Democratic Republic of Congo, but in Rwanda, I had to train people in English because they have now adopted English as a medium of communication. I should maybe go back here. The Moodle version I used was Moodle 1.9 back then, and the next bit now, as you can see, if you can read this, I have you know, lecturers and other people who were on a training program have developed resources and activities, mainly assignments and choice. There's a question there from this. Oh, different subjects. Somebody is asking me what subjects were taught. Different subjects across the board. You know, there are people from medicine, people from science, people from agriculture. It was a mix of different subjects. You know, people had to create courses for themselves. Now, as you can see, glossaries have been created and wikis. Now, the objectives of the training are there in French. I can quickly translate. So, renforcer les capacités des personnels. So, it reinforces staff capacity. And the second point there, former les dix personnels en méthode de concept, de conception, développement, de module de formation en ligne. So, train them in methods of design, development, and online stuff like that. Thank you, Abdullah. Now, the research study now, we are going to see more information about the research. So I asked a question before we start the training, as I said before, how many times have you used Moodle? I asked the question to all the people. It was a paper-based questionnaire. And this is what they said. You see here, almost everyone said, 31 out of 14 said they never had any experience. And they have used different methods to collect the information or data, interviews, speaking to people face to face, and then also using a questionnaire, as I said. And there was a self-evaluation at the end of every training session. You have to do self-evaluation on a post-it note, and you have to share the information so that everyone knows. It was also a one-to-one discussion with people, during breaks and during training also. Somebody's asking, where was this? Maybe it's a question for Nelly, not me. Now, this is what I've just said earlier. More information here. So 31 out of 14 didn't have any experience. 4 out of 14 had other experiences with other online learning experiences. And 2 out of 4 had used Moodle once a month, maybe during the training. Now, one of the comments from the user was that before the training, I had no information on the software. We see more comments later. Next bit, the research study. Data collection, as you can see, I have asked people a lot of questions. It was a data analysis. I was trying to gauge the skills and needs of people and identify the problems and if there was a demand before the training. This was done before the training, so we know whether there is a demand and people are ready, and also the institutions are ready. They have the computers, they have the people who need to do it. And there was motivation also. All this was done before we start training, so we know what to do. Now, their users' experiences. I asked them questions, what are the challenges? And they said there was, and also this is from research, there was large numbers, or there were large number of students from secondary school coming to the university, though there are fewer resources at the university. So there was a mismatch between secondary and university. As you can see there, inadequate and poor instruction is also another issue. And the amount of students are at University of Burundi, about 10,000, that was 2011. And you're talking about, just to give you one idea, maybe, okay, the population of Burundi is about 10 million. Just now, if my last count was okay. Now, so you see, 10,000 people out of 10 million, they go to university. It's not much. You can compare yourself to where you are. Research says that there's inadequacy between instruction and employment. So people are being trained, but employers complain that the training they receive is not what they should be getting. Yes. No, is insufficient or lack of staff, as I said at the beginning.
Now,
again, large numbers of students. So by 2013, it's expected that, at least next year, it's expected that between 30 and 40 students will be entering universities in the country. Though it is still insufficient lack of computers, as I said. Maybe this is something you need to know. So one computer for 300 students. This is shocking. Anyway, it's what the country is like. It's nothing to. I mean, I know where I come from. It's a big jump. Believe me, one computer for 300 students. You can't just compare, context. This is a great achievement. Of course, it's still much need for much room for improvement. People are concerned about online safety. One of the teachers asked me a question when I was starting to train that they were trying to find out whether computers will replace teachers, and I said to them, oh. Yes, I hear the concern. I don't think computers we are here to replace teachers. Also, someone said, what if I put my course online? What's going to happen to my course? People are going to download stuff instead of protecting myself and my data. So there's a lot of concern there. Teachers, as anywhere, teachers have a heavy workload, and they lack the time, and they don't have the basic skills. Apart from Moodle, there was a question I asked about basic computer skills they have, whether they can example an example whether they can after they finish working on a file document, a Word document, or they can save document under a PDF. People were like, "What are you talking about?" And I was like, "We need this to protect data." And also converting files in general—that was a problem. And making comments online using the computer was also a problem. People didn't know how to do that, so I had to go through all these skills before I move on, and though it was not part of my limit. Now, as I said earlier, there was much intrinsic motivation. People were very keen to learn new technologies and new skills, as we see on one of the participants' comments. They wanted to improve knowledge. We see this on the participants' comments 4, 5, and 7. And they wanted professional development, and they want certification, of course. So certificate is something people are always looking for, not just looking for improvement or developing skills. Certificate. Now, there was a slide earlier where we managed to get to see all their the questions that I asked, or all the experiences, if I should say. Now, as you can see, this one here, the top one about most of people managed to log in. This was after or during the training. They could distinguish users, and they could set courses themselves. As I said, to you, different courses, law, medicine, every faculty at university was represented. And they monitor your students, and they could activate or exit Moodle, and they could integrate resources and or create them, and engage students in communication activities, and they assessed they might create assessment activities, and they knew how to manage a course and monitor and back up a course and other experiences also. So that's what we did. Next bit. Now let's now talk about feedback from the users. What they said. Of course, this is my translation from French. This is the first participant who said, "I managed to create a virtual course." It's like, wow. So this is the first time in my life I've done it. And I have added a course, and I prepared a questionnaire, and I managed to convert a file into a PDF. This is what I said earlier. See, this person didn't have a clue. They didn't know how to convert files, so they did it. And using Microsoft or other software applications like Zamzar. I don't know if you know, you have used Zamzar. I got them to use Zamzar, which is a free software, and it can convert files from different formats. And they might change the appearance of Moodle. Next, participant says, "I made contact with the Moodle software. I have some knowledge of making online courses." So this is what I said earlier. Some people had some previous experience, and they said, "Oh, I practice in a book with my course." This is an issue because in some universities across the world, in Burundi particularly, it's a very much teacher-centered approach they use. So I got them to try and kind of change the approach so they can work together face-to-face, also online. So it was a great achievement for them. This person said, "Before the training, I wondered how I could participate in an online course, and now I know that with Moodle, I manage a million things. This is amazing." So very enthusiastic, you can see. Next, another participant said, "Oh, I have improved my knowledge managing platform Moodle, making files, and converting documents in different formats." Next one says, "Oh, I don't have the same needs as before the training, which is amazing. And I learned a lot about Moodle, but time was insufficient." So time was too for them. So, six, before the last participant, this is what he said, "For me, the training objective were achieved. Except how to train such students. This happens when you train or when you teach. Some people get on well with the work, others don't, this is part of the experience anyway." And said, "I expected that I know the concept of Moodle can be accessed easily. I need to better develop my knowledge in using Moodle." So they asked for more training and more and more and more so they can become more confident. And last participant, "Before the training, I had no information on the software. After having undergone the Moodle training, I have improved my knowledge." That's what I'm looking for. Now, review quickly, a quick review. This is what happened. This is what the experience was like. So logging in Moodle is, I said before, people were able to log in Moodle and manage to enroll in a course and create a course. So what I did, I created a course first, a kind of sandbox where they have to train, you know, get their hands dirty, and I told them, don't worry, you can't break Moodle, you know, make as much practice as you can before they move on to their own courses, of course. And then they might distinguish users' roles, teachers' roles, students' roles, you know, different roles, actually. They also might set course formats, different formats, sorry, thematic, weekly, and informal formatting. So they could change course format from, I told an example, I just to make sure they knew or I knew what they were doing. I said, okay, I looked at the course format, maybe from one participant. I said, okay, let's now see how we can change the format from thematic, if it was organized under themes, maybe, or topics. Let's see if we can change and make it a weekly based format course. And they could do that so that everyone can knows how to change the setting. So enrolling students was also something they did, and of course activating and exiting edit mode in the course, and navigating to blocks. Next, yes, they might do a lot actually now. Integrating and managing communication tools like a forum and a chat, they got that, they got to communicate between themselves. Actually, I asked them to do, I gave them a link to Moodle a book. I think it's called Moodle 1.9, and it's an open source. They had to do some reviews, so I put them in groups. A group would be talking on, example, or researching forums, how you make forums, how you make them work, and then they post reviews. Another group would be working on another topic from same book. So it was amazing. So sharing information, because it was a huge book, a large book to read for one person in one session. So what I got them to do, I divide the group into different groups. I gave them one chapter or a small section from the book that they can read and then share information. So, and then the forum was used to share the information too and discuss. Now, they knew how to create multimedia resources, a text page, a web page, and engage students in collaborative activities like glossary or wiki. Actually, what we did together, of course, in my course first, I showed them how to demonstrate how to create a Moodle glossary using Moodle activities. Actually, I used Moodle terms, like if they didn't know what a forum was, I had to give them a definition of a forum using a glossary, so that they can first they know what a forum means, or any other word which was a bit confusing. As you can imagine yourself, Moodle has got a lot of jargon or technology related words. Some people don't know, so you have to make sure people know the meaning of those words. They also assessed and evaluated students, so each other, and they gave feedback online. Now, the next bit is about more. Here, I'm trying to review or going back to what I've said before from the chat, from the chat I showed you. So they could manage course files, and they offered participants a space for sharing experiences. They create their own courses, and they monitor the participants' activities, and backing up and restoring a course content is also something they do. Now recommendations. We are now nearing the end of this presentation. So I made recommendations to policymakers. Here I'm talking about university institutions across the board, across the five universities, staff and administration. You know, people who got the policy, or let me call them policymakers. Now I told them, oh, this is an open source. It's free. for downloading, get free help and free support. And it's 24/7 access, anytime, anywhere. And it can be used to teach masses. And my point is, why not try Moodle? Because if you compare it to other learning softwares like Blackboard, which are not free, this one offers a lot of potential. Now, other recommendations I've met are here. Moodle supports fully online course or blended courses. Doesn't have to be the whole course online. It's part of it. Whatever is suitable. And it supplements face-to-face courses. It's been organized under Goethe's philosophy of learning, social constructionism, or constructing knowledge together, and supports group learning. And the point also I'm making here is that teachers need to be trained, and also students, not just Moodle, basic computer skills, as I said. They also need to be trained for new roles. As I mentioned earlier, if you coming from or talking about a teacher-centered environment, changing paradigm from teacher-centered to learner-centered, it takes a long, it's a long process, and people are not sure what to do. So they need to be trained in that the new role they play, like being a facilitator or independent learning or group learning or things like that. So they need to be trained. And one research says that in Burundi, 82% of lecturers are teacher-centered. That's what I was saying earlier. So things need to change, and Moodle can help. And next slide. What needs to be done? Assessment needs to be improved, and evaluation also. And assessment objective need to be reviewed, be a formative assessment, not for failing students in Burundi or in some parts of Africa. Teachers are famous for failing students, they get away with it. And research says is that they need to review the assessment strategies. So use assessment for learning rather than for failing people. So quality assurance needs to be developed, and there needs to be a focus on independent learning and research, and students need to learn independent learning skills also. And people need. Now, there's a lot of course there. Don't get me wrong. Course of instructor in terms of classroom, computer labs, training. So one of the solutions would be maybe to develop mobile learning across the country. As we said, as we saw earlier, there's a lot of mobile penetration in Africa. So some people believe that mobile learning could be also used, but there are issues there in terms of internet access, in terms of broadband, and things like that. So people need to share experiences, different people from different countries, different backgrounds, need to put their heads together and share experiences. And they also, there's a greater need for technological support. So people,
thank you. Thank you so much, Jean-Pierre. It was now, to hear you talk.
Recommendations
about
again. I'm about to finish, I think, quickly. A few minutes should be
like
finished.
The other participants are now taking
administration or
so
administration support.
Do you have any
support
tips
to, be,
to those
provided.
That
as I said, teachers need to be trained,
training
and students, they also need to be encouraged.
Any
and
tips from your
can build on the skill they have acquired before, like computer skills and Moodle skills. But my suggestion would be to start and keep it short and simple. Example, one Moodle course in one department. I've seen this happening in other places, like in the college where I work. When Moodle was introduced a few years ago, we started with one department, my department, one class, one course, a course 1 year. And then we experimented that, and then it was rolled out across the whole department in the college after. So start small and keep it short and simple. There is also a need to improve partnership, working with other universities, as I said, or other institutions, because people don't have skills, so they have to improve, you know, partner. It's there already. I know different universities in Burundi, in Rwanda, and Congo, they work together. There's a staff exchange, which is good, so this is something they need to develop. As I said, quality assurance needs to be
sorry for not being developed clear.
Internally,
I meant for the
externally,
individual,
not just internally. The ICT is starting to be developed and embedded in key
exactly.
subjects, not just
like yourself when you took Moodle courses.
And distance education also could be a solution to the problems, and encouragement and support is also needed. Now, there needs to be a balance between instruction and training and employment, I said earlier, so that what students get out of university matches with what employers are looking for. Example, basic computer skills, writing, you know, writing a CV, typing, those simple things, it's really important. And people need to use computers for teaching, research, and learning, not just for administration. There's a much use of computer for administration purposes. Also, save the trees. We need the trees. There's much global warming, and Africa has been struck, so Moodle can help. It is a reality, as I said. It can be used in a face-to-face and blended learning. There are many challenges which are in the implementation. It's more effort and resources needed, but most importantly, political will is a must. And if you have any questions, I will be happy to answer them. I think I should have a few minutes there to answer questions. If you have a look,
see
the references,
really
they are
important.
There. And
asking, but also
that's
getting
me.
Answers.
Thank you very
there's
much
a question there
any
from
questions?
You're a man, and the question is
sorry.
About
long
African students.
Tired.
What do they prefer, face to face or online?
Thank you.
Face-to-face experience. I was in Beijing. I said that people are finding it very, very hard to move from face to face to online. That's why I said it should be a slow. People have been used to learning or teaching face to face.
Now, as I said earlier, yeah, good question. Thank you, Nelly. Tips. As I said here, if you look at the slide there, I said start small. Start small. Thank you, Andrea. Thank you. Start small and keep it simple, because there's a lot of need there. There's infrastructure needed. You know, training is needed. You know, IT support is needed. You know, people install. I'm not advocating any, you know, any implementation of Moodle, you know, at once. I would, I've seen what's happening in other institutions. I would really encourage people, not just here in Africa, to start small experimentation, and then move on, and learn from experiences, and build on the experience, of course. Okay. Thank you, Esther.
Like face to face.
Thank you, Andrea.
I have been used to myself.
Yeah, these two things is quite a problem.
Oh, for individual
face.
Learners.
It's a problem, but things are changing.
No, yeah, yes.
There's a question. Thank you, Jean-Vier. There's a question here by Raymond.
Yeah, there's a lot of challenges. You know, first, Moodle is new to you. Oh, particularly from somebody who's got a language background like me. I don't have a computer or IT background, by the way. I'm a language man and teacher. So I had to learn a lot by myself. And most importantly, motivation. If people are motivated, which is the case, and I've seen this happening in Africa, where I've been, and also in other parts, motivation is the key, intrinsic motivation. If you need to learn, you need something, you need what you want, I don't think there is somebody that can stop you. And the internet is there to help. So, there are skills you need, basic skills, of course, and once you've got the skills, computer skills, then you can move on. Learning from others also is very important. I had to work with other people, working together, you know, sharing information, sharing knowledge, so that if I don't know, I ask, asking people you work with, asking organizers like Nelly has answered all or most of my questions. I was, you know, very pleased. Every time I was stuck, she was there looking and asking for help.
Now, what people have recommended or thought
asking
better would be to set aside a time, maybe a few days, without any teaching activities going on, so that they can devote the time to the training. And then,
it was a face-to-face experience I was engaged in, I said, but people are finding very, very hard to move from face-to-face to online. That's why I said it should be a slow, because people have been used to learning or teaching face-to-face. It's very hard to move to online, an online approach. Actually, what I was trying to do in the meantime, there was a lot of things involved. I had to show them how they can design a short course so that it can be suitable for online teaching and learning. What they thought in the first place, they thought they could copy and paste a whole course, for instance, from their computer to Moodle. That's what they thought when they first started. And I was like, no, it doesn't work that way. There's an approach. There's a process people need to learn. So face to face is still there, and it's there to remain. Believe me, as the research, said, 82% of lecturers at University of Gurun are teacher centered. So they like face to face. That's what I have been used to myself.
Kind of training I was doing. So it was based at the university, though.
It is a problem, but things are changing. Things are changing.
It was part of university service training, but that's why people were asking for certification. So yes, it's needed.
There's a question there about teacher training.
There is an ICT strategy, as I said. But the implementation is a problem. Yes.
But do you know of one specific one?
What I mean here is,
in Africa,
example, teachers were very, very frustrated because they had a very heavy workload. As you know yourself, you are a teacher. For a teacher, there's a lot happening same time. You know, there is example, teaching
yes,
going on,
like
marketing going
money.
On. There's
everybody's trying to make money.
And this training was, you know, came up, and people were like, "I don't want to miss this training. It's very important."
And on universities,
so
I mean, they don't have
a clash
of
timetables. Time was an issue. So participation was really
so
okay. So the strategy
I
would was there. They also had, they organized the training, the funding, they got the funding, which is really good, which is also another part of the implementation of the strategy, but it was not enough. Now, what people have recommended or thought would be better would be to set aside a time, maybe a few days, without any teaching activities going on, so that they can devote the time to the training. And then for implementation, they would go back to their classroom and try things out.
But the problem
was, Moodle was only accessible through the university internet. After the training, I had to just do some part of this with research. Go back to some of my teachers and ask them, did you manage to get
people are going to be thinking of all kinds of questions after the session as well.
Software was installed on the internet. No way they could access it from outside.
Thank you so much, everyone, for joining.
But from
thank
the
university.
Also, computers, an issue. Students were not trained. Teachers are not trained. It's a problem.
Tom just added the link to, and it's invalid. I have no idea. It picks, oh my gosh. Let me extend the class.
Yep.
That's a wrong link, Tom. It's, let me get the link for you. Okay, so that, do you have it, Janvier? Do you have the link?
Yeah. The link for what? For the
Moodle MOOC.
Yeah.
For
yep.
some
yep.
reason,
pretty much
you
so.
Know
yep.
that
yep.
links change. Sometimes they change. Yeah, they change in the process of being brought in. So there's the link.
Oh, actually, that was an any service
yeah,
kind of training
that.
I was doing. So I, it was based at the university, though
lost me
some people
there.
Had to move
it's,
from their own
the
bases
box.
And move to the university.
There.
It was an in service training, so it was part of
you lost me. Well, I'm still
university
here.
Service training, but
yeah, I can do, but I don't know.
That's why
the
people
chat box.
Were asking
Maybe the,
for
oh,
certification.
I see. You should
so,
have the same controls. The chat box is
yes.
at the bottom. Maybe
oh, yes.
it went
it's
somewhere.
Needed. Yes.
Oh, it's still Janvier. Do you see it now? I saw that you added to the chat bad request and valid URL. Try the one that I just added. Is it still bad? That would be weird.
Yeah. I can see that now. Yeah, thank you very much. Yeah.
You got it? Okay, I just checked it.
Sorry.
And it's okay. In addition, Janvier, do you see the copy chat? If not, we will one of us will copy the chat.
I can find out and let you know.
So well,
course, you mean a free teacher training institution?
He's done it. Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
There's so much going on. I didn't manage to get through it all.
Yes, a lot going on.
Reflection tool.
Yeah. Well, Tom has copied the chat, so that's fine, and he will share it in the course feed. All right. So thank you, Janvier. Thank you, everyone, again, and see you at the next session, Janvier. Join us from Australia.
But, I was in the conference I was in Tunisia last year.